Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. And today, I'd like to open our Dharma talk with three important topics. Wherever we go on Earth, we find these three phenomena. And the first is attachment. And it comes straight away from our being born. If we were not attached to this body mentally, we couldn't be born. That's how it begins. The body is formed by mother and father, and our mind attaches to it. It's our first attachment, and we don't even know about it. And without this attachment, we are not born. That's how a sentient being is formed, body and the mind together. And unless we understand the nature of this mind and the nature of this body, we cannot navigate through our lives and deaths successfully. So what are we supposed to do when our first attachment is not even visible, is not even conscious, and that's how we are formed? Well, first of all, we have got to be aware of it. That this is the condition of a sentient being, that we are attached. So the Buddha's path is really using attachment, the state of being attached, to become free from attachment and being attached. That's a really important point. In fact, the most skillful paths on earth use the condition that we are living in to relieve from those conditions. If we cannot use our current situation, then we are trapped. So, if you see something and you like it, you identify with it, and you say, ah, that's my view, that's my landscape, it's my preferred form, because it's beautiful, it's pleasing, and that's mine, or that's me, and that's how attachments are formed. And that's how identifications are formed. It's so strong that when youth in Tibet, they are selected for greater or smaller duties, they are given objects, and if they choose the yomju, the mala, over some tool or something else, then they might be taken for a lama, to be trained in a monastery. But don't think it's so special that only they do that. We do the same thing. Our parents look at us, our choices, and what we choose in our infant lives heavily depend on our previous lives. So our choices are coded from time immemorial, ever since we kept being born and dying and born and dying and had our experiences. And the question is, where are these choices stored? How could we access them? How could we find our attachments and relieve them? Because if we keep being identified with our attachments, then our identity is also attached. We attach to our I, our sense of ego. And whenever we feel that this is violated or attacked, then we become aggressive. So first we have attachment, then we have identification, and in its strongest form, identification can become addiction. You not only are identified with your favorite food, you can't live without it, you can't go without it, and you don't want to eat any other food, you are addicted. Saturday nights, you can see an addiction walking, you know, very, very feebly on two legs after they exited, you know, a suji, you know. When they finish drinking, and that temporary social addiction is taking over, then they don't have to think, they only feel, and most important is feel the way home, you know. So we shouldn't think of attachment as something extreme or something peculiar or exceptional, because we all are. That's number one. But if everybody's wearing yellow glasses, nobody says, oh, the world is yellow, because everybody sees it in the same way. Everybody experiences it from the same situation. So we don't even recognize it anymore. And because of that, we don't even recognize the way our I, my, me functions. So the most invisible item is inside of us. It's what we call the ego, I, my, or me. And unless we discover the way it is, unless we discover its function, we cannot improve ourselves. We keep going around, around, around in circles. And the largest circle that we know of is the circle of life and death. But there are smaller circles, you know, habit forces that make us do this, and then the opposite within the same time frame, within visible time frame. Like people get married, and they divorce, and they get married again, and they divorce again. They learn something, and they forget. They study something else, believing that it's better, that they also forget that. They believe in something, then they become disillusioned. Then they believe in something again, and disillusioned again. So if you look at the small scale, the large scale, it works in the same way. You eat, you feel happy, you exert yourself, and use the toilet and become hungry again. So if you look at the way we function, small scale, large scale, short term, long term, one lifetime, many lifetimes, it's pretty much cyclical, going along seemingly linear time. Many cycles in linear time. So what can we do about it? If we were so happy being attached, identified slash addicted, and being aggressive, we wouldn't be sitting here finding some alternatives. We wouldn't be searching for some solutions. But the fact that we suffer while doing all this, that warrants for some search. So what was the first search warrant that humanity ever issued? The first is, what are we doing here, on this planet, in this body, what's the purpose? And many religions were given, many other social sciences and historical culture, etc., artifacts were given to us as a guide, as a probable solution. But which one is it? Or which ones go to the very root of our existence? The way we are attached to our senses. The way we can become addicted to sensory perceptions. And the way we can respond aggressively when we are being attacked. When we feel that this ego is being violated. So which one goes there? As long as you look for the root outside of yourself and you trust a religion, a spirituality, a person, a set of books to find that for you, it's never going to happen. Only you can find it. And the moment you take that responsibility upon yourself, the moment you start your own search, that moment you get all the help you need. But before that, as long as you want to vest that responsibility to someone else, externalize it, as modern economics say, you will never find it. Because if you get the solution from an external source, the solution remains external. It goes through you. If you don't make the effort, if you don't experience it for yourself, it's never yours. That's the difference of becoming a mountain climber, learning all the ropes, having all the training, and then in a year or two climbing up to one of the great heights of the mountains. Anything above 8,000 is considered a great achievement. Not just Chomoluma or Mount Everest. Anything above 8,000 meters is considered great. But if you get a helicopter and you get taken up there, that peak is never yours. You never conquered it. You just got it. And the moment you depart with the same vehicle, you lose it. And that's why it's important that you do it yourself. Not alone, but out of your own effort. So first of all, we have to discover how these attachments are formed, and A, very important, A, stop your judgments about them. So don't judge yourself and others just because we are in this situation, mind and body together, mind as objects, like and dislike mind, memories, etc. We are attached to all these, we identify with all these. And we have very strong passions and very, very big addictive tendencies. Look around. And the first thing is that you don't become judgmental about them. I have less attachments, I'm a better person. That, he, she. More attachments. Lying down is flat out very bad person. Common thinking, right? That's the way we think. That's the way our value systems are formed. But if you want to help yourself and help others, number one important thing is stop being judgmental about it. Be, number two, have a clear direction of what you want to do. If you don't know what you want to do, then your passions and your habits start to control you and you're torn apart into 10,000 little pieces. Your level of awareness goes down. And then you are seemingly the victim of something outside. No. You are your own victim. The victim of your own ignorance, your own desire, and your own. So first of all, seek in a non-judgmental and clear way, and B, have some direction, have some purpose. Otherwise, you become your own victim. And number C, if you really, really attain freedom from attachment and addiction and aggression, then try to help other people. There are so many great teachings and methods to do that, and I want to emphasize now too. Both are within the realm of the chants and mantras that you all know here. Some of you may have practiced it a lot, some of you have practiced it maybe a little. But fortunately, we are sitting in a country where the native, among many other native traditions, the native tradition here in this spot is Buddhism. And Korean Buddhism has a huge collection of wonderful, skillful means to perceive these attachments, to see the roots of these attachments, and become free from these attachments, which come naturally from our own existence. And these two chants, which I want to explain a little bit, are the two dharanis of great significance. One is the Dei Bi Ju, the great compassionate dharani, and it's within the Chosukyong, the Thousand Eyes in Hand Sutra. And if you search long enough, you find the meaning in original Sanskrit, also in any Punjab or Chinese character, and also in English. And that comes to many of your native languages also. So what's interesting about the Dei Bi Ju is that it sets a very clear direction. Awakening, awakening. Moccha, moccha, if you remember the text. Okay? That's from moksha. So it sets very clearly the direction to your own life if you recite that. Awakening, awakening. And then other parts, forward, forward, until the flower garland becomes complete. Okay, until your mind is completely awakened. So mantras are very simple because it's like the basic code to your mind. As you recite it, it goes deeply into your unconscious, and whether you know the meaning intellectually or not, it does the same job. It's pretty hard to believe, but it does. Without you knowing the meaning or not knowing it, it's important that you imprint it into your consciousness as the strongest habit force. And if that's the strongest habit force, that's what your mind follows. It's pretty much like jungle law. Biggest and loudest and strongest animal controls everything else. Your mind operates in the same way. So if you can do that, that you build up the strongest habit force to wake up, that's what's going to happen. If you have stronger habit forces than awakening, then that's what's going to happen. So if you really recite the Dei Bi Ju wholeheartedly, then your mind naturally follows that. But it's really interesting that when I learned the Dei Bi Ju first, like 22 years ago, I had no idea what it means. In our Dharma book, it said mantra, no translation. By that time, it was true. But with the advent of internet technology, you could get pretty much everything you want in terms of knowledge there. And later on, after 15 years, I learned the meaning, but it didn't change the effect of the mantra one single bit. Okay? So that mantra tells your mind to become completely free from any attachments and don't identify with that, don't become addicted to anything, and least of all should you be aggressive, because that stops becoming one with the universe. That stops you from truly perceiving somebody's mind. That stops you from being an enlightened and awakened person, and that's why compassion is so important. Compassion is not important so that you could indulge in it and say, how good am I? If you say, how good am I during your spiritual practice, it's a self-defeating sentence. Because ultimately the purpose was to become free from your notion of I. So if you actually make it stronger by your good opinions, it's contrary to the original purpose. So the Devi Ju tells your mind, and by this you are conditioning yourself to be compassionate and awakened person. And here's the second catch. First catch is that you don't know the meaning that it works. The second catch is you don't know the way, but it happens. So you might say with your own rational intellect, alright, yes sir, so how do I do that? What's the method? We don't know. We don't know. We don't know what it is actually, and we don't know how. If we just do it, it happens. How? Just like in the Heart Sutra, the third important piece of chanting that we already recited today, by ruling out the wrong ways, you go the right way. Because the right way in this case is undefinable. You cannot really put a label on it. And you cannot really define the GPS coordinates how you reach Nirvana, because it doesn't have those coordinates. So if you just stay away from the wrong ways, you go the right way. If you have no hindrance, then you have no fear. So we don't know what it is actually, we cannot define it, but we can experience it. We also don't know how we get there, but if we stop indulging in our dualistic thinking and attach addictive passions, then we can naturally go that way. Okay. And the other dharani, the other important, you know, chanting in Korean tradition, which I came close to and we practice that at one box every day, is the Nim Om Ju. It's the Shurangama mantra or the Pratyangiram dharani. It starts with a great image that the transformation bodies appear above the Buddha's head. And that's all the changes that you can go through in lifetimes. You can become this kind of existence and that kind of existence. You can become a human being, a hungry ghost, an animal, an asura, a Buddha, a bodhisattva. All of them appear. And all of them teach you what it is to be born, what it is to have a mind, and what it is to go through the cycles of lives and deaths. And while doing so, you pray that you do not enter certain realms and you stay away from the ways of, in our case, attachment, addiction, and aggression. And there's a whole list what you don't want to do. And there's a whole list what you actually want to do. And if you put that into your consciousness as the strongest habit force, that's where you will go. That's what you will be doing. And again, we don't know how. But you tell your mind, do that, and eventually we do that. And what's really amazing in this mantra, which lasts almost 15 minutes, even if you chant it real quick, that when you recite all those states of mind which can overwhelm you and overcome you, although you don't want that, the last part is a prayer that we would overcome all these unwholesome states of mind and unwanted states of existence by kindness and compassion. Why? Because there's no other way to overcome that. So if you have a very dualistic, repressive and aggressive relationship to something that you don't want, then you make it stronger. If you don't dare to face it, if you don't dare to perceive it, and if you don't dare to really acknowledge it, then that state of mind, that kind of existence becomes stronger. And that's what we need to understand. You love it, become stronger. You hate it, become stronger. Just the polarity is different. If you want to truly become free from something, someone, remove all your energy. Completely remove all your energy, only perceive it like in a mirror, which has no good, no bad, no likes, no dislikes, no attachment. And that opens the path to freedom. So that's why mantras and chanting are so important. Because if you do not condition your mind, the exterior will condition you. If you don't open your eyes, there are 10,000 dusts before them, electronic culture or non-electronic culture. In a computer screen, or a big LCD screen, or in books and newspapers, and anything that you can read and see, understand, or visualize. Hear, taste, smell, touch, or think, or feel. All of these can overwhelm you or open you up. It's your choice how to use them. Because as long as we are in this body, we have sensory perceptions. As long as we migrate over life and death, we have choices. What choices do you make? That is the most important question, moment to moment. What choices do we make? And if the direction of these choices is clear, then your lives and deaths go on the path of awakening. And you can become free and help other people become free from their original attachments, addiction, and aggression. So I appreciate your very kind attention for the introductory. And I would like to continue with your questions, hoping that I can answer them. Because it's much more important what you want to know than what I want to say. Okay, so if you have any questions, please hold your hand up and then I'll notice you. You can ask anything you want. Just like the doctor doesn't care about the ouch of the patient when there has to be an injection. So, first of all, does that person have an open attitude or not? Because that openness comes only through some kind of insight into the nature of their suffering. So if they have suffered enough, then they open up enough to have that insight. And if they are not open, and they're not ready to be helped, if they are attached to their suffering, if they refuse any help, then you have to bear the emotional burden not to touch them. You can ask, you can offer, you can do a lot of things, but you cannot open the gate instead of them. So stand by. Stand by with your good bodhisattva attitude. And then, when the time comes, then these people will be asking you first, because you've been there the longest. You are the kindest, you are the strongest, and not moving from that position. You really have to believe in this so that you could help them, not kind of bounce around. Because if their sickness or their negative attitude is stronger than your positive attitude, you lose. So, perceive their situation. Find the root of their suffering. Number two, find the medicine for that suffering. and stand by. So when their mouth open, you can offer it. When their minds open, you can teach them. Not before. And many times human beings are like that. I've seen that in my family. I've seen that in my culture. I've seen that in Asia. I've seen that inside and outside the temples. It's everywhere. People are suffering and they're proud of it. People are suffering and they want to convince you to join them in their suffering so that they're not alone. People are depressed and they refuse to acknowledge it. Instead, they put up very nice faces so that you would see them bright and happy. And if you look close enough, they are inside, dead. So really perceive them as they are. In fact, they will start to trust you when you see them better than they see yourselves, themselves. Okay? You've seen the situation, then you have correct relationship. Correct relationship is ready to help. And correct function is sometimes being patient. So completely clear your mind of all the thoughts that you might be able to form initially. We call that don't know. The mind is before thinking. And that don't know prevents you also from being judgmental, as I said during the introductory. And when that happens, then you can become one with their minds without being identified or attached to them. Because that's one of the biggest dangers. Some people act like black holes and they suck you in. All your energy is gone and you flat out. And you don't know what happened. That means you went too close. Instead of giving them the medicine, you became food for them. It's different. Okay? So there's a lot of things and, you know, using many skills you can try. Okay? More questions? Any kind of question. Yeah, so I
is the continued dedication to some sort of practice or behavior that's beneficial to you, out of commitment to that, is that not a form of addiction and so?
Well, try to let go of it. If you can, you're not addicted. If you cannot let go of it, then you are addicted or attached. That means, you know, I've been practicing, you know, for over 20 years, and some people can see, actually can ask with a big smile on their faces, you know, can you see yourself without one day of formal meditation? And I have to say happily, yes, of course. It's always a decision to come to the Dharma room or not, to wake up early in the morning or sleep in. It's always a decision, and there's no kind of machine that prompts me to do it always, everywhere, all the time. It's always a decision. And if you can decide this way or that way, as I always do, then you're not addicted because you didn't lose your decision-making power. So, very simple. Can you say no? Of course. Then can you say yes? Of course. Then you're not addicted. Can you do it? That's it. Enough, or do you want some more? Okay, fantastic. Other questions, ladies and gentlemen? We are just getting warmed up, okay?
One of the mantras that you suggest us to recite in the chapter of
anything that you really connect to is okay. Because you have to believe in that mantra 100% so that it would have correct effect. So I gave two examples, the Nyingomchu and the Deibiju, and of course the Heart Sutra, which we do at Mongguangsa in Hungary every single day. And I personally really believe in these mantras and practices because they seem to connect to my heart 100% and I connect. But originally, if you recall the teaching, all formations are completely empty. So it depends on your mind how you perceive those mantras and what kind of practice is good for you. So when you ask this question, I have to say any mantra is good to which you can connect 100%. For some people, Kwansan Bosa, this very short mantra which is recited in thousands of temples every single day, Kwansan Bosa is everything. simple,
sure,
and clear. If you 100% believe in that, because you 100% connect to that, there's no need for anything else. So what is it that your mind connects to? So I know I have a complex consciousness, so a complex mantra helped me. So that's good. Some people have very simple consciousness, simple mantra, no problem. Anything that 100% connects to you, you believe in correct content, correct direction, and you do it. No problem. Right. More questions? Yes, back there.
How does one break addiction not to a particular thing, but maybe a particular way of life or a particular way of thinking?
That's harder, you know. If it's a particular way of life to which somebody seems to be addicted to, then a lot of traveling is important. Because it can get you out of home, gets you out of your comfort zone, breaks your habit force. That's number one. And if you're attached to a particular way of thinking, then you have to meet a lot of different people. If you work in the same building, in the same office for 10, 15 years, your mind really becomes narrow and you don't even notice it because you can get good money for it, right? So it's really important to visit many places if your way of life is too comfy and you become totally zoomed in and that's it. And the other is interacting with a lot of different people so that your way of thinking would have to change. There was a very interesting experiment. They did it in East Coast America. And I'm not sure I quote the title quite well, but they made a documentary about it. It's called Millionaires in Disguise or something like that. So some people, just like you asked this question, some people recognized that they became entrapped by their own high standard of living and efficient and really productive way of thinking. And these guys were all millionaires. So they of course have the means to find everything they want. So they found an agency which offered special course to relieve them from this incarcerated feeling in their well-being. So these folks, they had to put on correct everyday clothing, just like anyone taking the subway on Manhattan, okay? And they had to connect to very poor people, they had to rent an apartment, they had to live like anyone else. And it was an option whether you would take a job or not, but you had to go into places where people work for normal wages, like 10, 15 bucks an hour. And they had to interact with them. They had to get themselves accepted, and they couldn't reveal their identity at all. The shortest was 1 week, and I think the longest was like 1 month, or even maybe 2 or 3 months, I'm not sure. But at least 1 week, otherwise no chance. And their task was that when all this is finished, and they have to write a diary every single day, they have to write a diary, what they go through, how they feel, what they experience, who they talk to, what kind of interaction, and also their reflections on it, so their cognition would change. So when that started to happen, especially the first week, people were shocked. They never thought that the world is actually like this. Because for them, until that point in time, everything was like television. And they could afford to sit in their comfortable armchair, which could be their house, their car, their social environment, their little niche in which they were kind of imprisoned by their own situation. They never realized how much people are alive, because they felt they were not alive before. And that's a very interesting one. They had all the money they wanted, but they didn't feel alive because they didn't have meaningful human connections and relationships. So they go through all these changes, and sometimes they also suffer and thereby attain the suffering of those few, especially lower Manhattan, and you have a huge house, one of those few residential areas that are still there. And those folks, they sometimes scream at each other over the corridor, and some of those, you know, millionaires in disguise, they never heard anything like that before. They never lived in an apartment block for rent. They never had big neighbors. know, I mean, big family neighbors with a lot of, you know, strength and a lot of energy. So they never had to scream over the corridor. Things like that. And the last one, that they had to go back after they returned to their own habitat. They had to go back in the same attire as, same kind of attire which they used to wear in their training. They had to give a donation, and they had to reveal their true identity, so as to finish the disguise part, which is partly a lie, because they are not who they seemed to be. And then, tears were flowing in everybody's faces to actually connect truly to one another. And I believe, unless we do something like this on Earth at a larger scale, then 7 billion people will be controlled by a super class of 7,000. It's 1/10,000th of our actual population. And by average measurements, about 80% of all the wealth in this world are controlled by this super class of 7,000 people. The highest amount is in the Western world, but China is coming up real fast. But I would say the westernized countries. So, unless we enter into some meaningful and compassionate relationship with one another, and this concentration and compartmentalization of wealth will cause such deprivation that tens of millions of people could die just because of that. It will come out in many forms, like famine, drought, underemployment, overpopulation, but it's just the surface. Deeper down there, the actual cause is that we don't relate to each other. We identify with our situation, we are addicted to our own ways of life, and we are not ready to share because we would rather build walls than find expedient means to balance out these huge huge differences that we have on this planet. And these huge opposites and differences, it can really tear up, you know, the current fabric of society, which from the outside can seem to be a really globalized and kind of more and more unanimous society, because you can fly everywhere, you can buy anything anywhere, you can get any kind of information, because we seem to be a global village, but we forget that this global village is really mismanaged. It is a global village with a huge management problem, and we have to fix that. And to the extent that we wake up, to that extent we can fix that. And if we don't, we are not doomed, we are not victimized, but we have to suffer the consequences of our own actions, our own thoughts, our own speech, everything. So thanks for the good question. More questions, anyone?
Yeah. How would you help communities that are
I don't know. You know, it's just, you know, my first response, you know, in the last couple of years always is feeling that small duck follows big duck. So, my teacher appeared in 1991 in Hungary, Sunim, and there was no question that I become his disciple, there was no doubt. I met this meditation style a couple of months, like 6 months before, in 1990, in the autumn. At that time I had serious questions and there were no answers on the horizon. I rejected everything because I saw the flaw in everything except within myself. That's a tough one. It's pretty tough to have somebody smart and really knowledgeable about ways and means and being negative about the approach, because you had to defend yourself from the outside influences which you saw, I saw, as improper or not leading to the right goal, to the right purpose. And my purpose was to really become free from every single thing which I felt inside or thought inside, it just became too much. And after a while, your doubts and unresolved problems and conflicts reach a critical mass, you can get into deep crisis. And that crisis, ultimately, when you look back at it, it really helped. It had to happen, you know. And I'm not going into this emotional reaction that I'm being grateful for it, or I feel fantastic after it, you know, this kind of uber positive type of things. No, it would be fake. I felt like S-H-I-T, you know, completely down. I was really grateful for the three treasures that appeared in my life. But nobody wanted to convert me to anything. I had to make the effort, but the direction was clearly shown. And only my experience counted. I didn't have to believe in anything without actually seeing it inside. And that was great. And that's when I say loss is gain. You lose your illusions, you lose your own crap. And what happens? Your own true nature starts to be met. Starts to kind of send the first signals. No. And the first is, are you listening? That's the first question. Or you are still being stupid. Still wrapped up in your own ideas. And the first thing is, are you ready to see that the sky is blue? If yes, hello. The whole world is open. Only you make up your own problems. So the moment you stop making your problems, they disappear. Simple, clear, and totally unambitious. I mean, nobody wanted anything from me. And that's why I love it. You don't become someone else. I mean, this is an attire that I came to like, but I can go, you know, without the tikas, but that's no problem. So I'm happy to have everyday Sun walk and not just a ceremony of thing. But this is a lifestyle that I'm ready to follow and do just because I believe in it. And it also came so naturally when people ask about it. It just came as a very strong impulse in 1992 April, a year after Susan Sunim's visit in Budapest. Yeah, this is what I want. And I gave myself time to have my university degree. In fact, the post-grad also just to have some good job if something fails. I fail. Something to fall back on. Never had to happen. Especially because if you really follow the path that you believe in step by step, and there are no holes and no gaps, that means no built-in flaws into the structure. It's not a matter that your hidden karma comes out, it's something else that your homework appears in a different form, but if your structure inside is clear, it's a mental structure, it's your decisions, it's something like the integrity of your own personality. If that's not breached, then you can actually deal with anything that appears, and also anyone. Sometimes you can really surprise yourself. So what happens during the retreat is something that everyone in Hollywood would want. 1,000 movies appear. But then something happens which nobody could bear in Hollywood, that none of those movies are made. None of them reach the screens. Because your job is not to watch a movie or follow some kind of karma. Your job is to attain the light that makes all those movies possible. So, I think I grew into it, and I will grow out of it when I die. That's it. Alright? More questions? Yeah. It was not easy at all. It was not easy at all. In first 2 or 3 years, when you have the strongest ideas about practicing, when you entertain yourself after a couple of months that you actually can practice, then that's when you make the biggest mistakes. And I think I was really hitting myself in the head with my practice. When you try to use thinking to control thinking, you are up the creek very soon. And I am a stubborn kind of animal, so I didn't acknowledge that. I went up the creek way up, and then it became a little more quiet. Thinking to control thinking is like fire and gasoline. You can't put out fire with gasoline. One passion to control it, no, other passions, it doesn't work. But you try whatever you believe in, and when you realize that it's insufficient, then you find something else. It's the way we all operate. So make your effort, and be patient with yourself at the same time. Of course, it's not easy out of life, I said that. But fortunately, when the Buddha started to teach, he never posted a sign before the place of the assembly, whichever grove they were in. Folks, easy path here. Enter. He never said that. But he also didn't say that it's difficult. You make difficult, you have difficult. And if you don't make anything, that's easy. Okay. More questions? Yeah.
When I'm meditating, sometimes I face my deep problems, like anxiousness, patience, or deep fear. When the fear comes to me, my ego protects me, so I fell asleep or I said ever and run away from that. So,
okay, so when that appears, before your mechanism to push it away appears, before the self-defense in the mind appears, ask the question, where does this come from? So we usually practice with the Huadu, what is this? And that what is this is everything basically you need. This can be focused on the karma, something as small as this little black recorder here, where it can focus on this huge, vast, empty space. Compared to that, this hall and the space in this wonderful Dharma hall is huge. So you can direct that question, like with a good camera, you can zoom into an object, even a very small thing, like a tiny butterfly. And you can zoom out and open it up into infinity, that only the moment that this objectless mind remains, which is no mind. So you can use the question in 10,000 ways. So when any kind of karma appears, have the courage to face it and ask, what is this? Where does this come from? If you ask, what is this? The layers appear, the layers of causality coded in that karma appear. So the first and most important point is have the great question, have the great courage to face it, and that gives you great faith. Because our karma is funny, you know, you look at it and it starts to first become visible, then it starts to disappear. Why? Because you have seen it. So your job is to perceive without being hopeful or fearful, attracting or rejecting. And when that happens, just by this pure perception, all that karma, which has no self-nature, returns to your original nature, giving you back the energy which you use to create that. Isn't that wonderful? You don't need a priest or a monk or anybody for that. You need yourself. And you can do it moment to moment, and that's true meditation. Meditation is not this. Meditation is when you see inside what's happening. And finally, you take correct control of your life. So, moment to moment, what is this? Where does this come from? And after a while, of course, outside, as you do your daily functions, it goes spontaneously and unconsciously, but with deep awareness. You know, when you talk to somebody, and what's your job? What do you do? A psychologist. Wonderful. So when you have a session, then you perceive your own patient or client, and you are fully engaged in the consciousness of that person, the whole mind, so that you could help, you could perceive what's happening. And then your job is to really ask, so what is this really? Where does this come from? Okay? But even if you're just a truck driver, then without verbalization, you have that question, what is this role? What am I doing right now? Or if there's anything coming, where does this come from and why? So it seems like a little bit like a dummy crash course on Zen, but believe me, it's not. You get going and the depths of this practice open up and you see what you haven't seen before. And that is better than any personal apocalypse. The original meaning of this Greek word, apocalypse, is exactly this: seeing something which arises from the death which had not been seen before. So if you do this regularly, if you clean your laundry letter, you know, regularly inside, you don't have to have big personal crises because you sit facing yourself every single day. And that prevents the accumulation of unfinished karma or unwanted mental contents or anything that you try to push behind yourself. You face it every day, so it doesn't accumulate into this critical mass. And then you don't have to crash, you don't have to have this huge crisis to actually force yourself to look at it. So no personal apocalypses are necessary at that time. Is this clear? Everybody is bright, wonderful looking, and nobody moves, and that's good. Okay? Does this answer your question? Alright, so every single day, clear mind, anything appears. What is this? Where does this come from? And be patient. Sometimes you are not quick to reveal, even for yourself, what kind of karma you have. It's shame inside. And if you keep shame inside, then comes shame outside. You become strong and clear inside, and same thing happens outside. Because originally this boundary is very, very virtual. It doesn't really exist. So don't be surprised that determined by your mindset, which you have outside events and meetings and everything coming to you. So how did you attract that? How did that happen to you? How did you start that kind of line of thoughts or emotions which attracted that person or those events or those people around you? Now that's true meditation, to ask without checking, making, holding, wanting, being afraid, none of the superfluous mental attitudes. Just clear, not moving mind. Perceive right here, right now. What is this? Where does this come from? And that is meditation. That is becoming clear. That is becoming free from all those afflictions, addictions, etc. Alright? Very good. More questions?
I can buy a pair of glasses today, and it costs a lot of money, and it was much more than I thought, and I remember feeling bad that it cost so much money, and then I remember thinking, how could people evolve without their eyesight, and I became upset with the concept of evolution, and then the world, and then the universe, and everything around us. So how can we stop ourselves from being judgmental and then having escalates into things, like if somebody walks in front of you when you're walking down the street, or if somebody is standing in front of the door on the subway, things, little things like this. How do you stop yourself from being judgmental of these things and stopping it from escalating?
Well, first of all, don't be judgmental about being judgmental. That's number one. So allow the judgment to arise, but if you don't judge the judgment, it starts to disappear faster and faster and faster, and then it becomes really like this one quantum, and then it disappears. It's so fast that you don't even act upon it. And then you lose the habit of being judgmental about it. Now, concerning the development and this evolutionary process of mankind, don't think you can change that from the outside. So you cannot go to school and young and say, "Sir, please, do not sell those glasses so expensive or so, high price." You go to any of those, high quality shops and you're shocked. That's correct. Maybe it's not your place to buy glasses. But the real question is, what do you do with your mind inside? So don't lose yourself in these externals. Assess the situation. You need a pair of glasses, and you assess how much you can spend on it, and then without any big loss of energy or superfluous thinking, you can go to the right place and buy that. Now, if we see it ramified, human evolution is also not linear. people love to think, ever since Darwin wrote his book, that, hey, we just, you know, we really got started about 400,000 years ago. We really hit the mark. Since then, Homo sapiens is sapiens sapiens, you know? And it's not really like that. We are walking in circles. This civilization is also walking in circles. So you can really see very well the rise, the kind of sustenance, and then the fall. What's really funny, we see it with the Mayas, we see it with the Romans, we see it with the Greeks, we see it with ancient China, we see it with Central Asia, we see it with the South American cultures. We don't see it now, right here, right now, with ourselves, at this point. Why? Because we are not willing to, especially those who really have to make tough decisions and leave their comfort zone, or just leave some of their profits behind, or leave their desire for power behind, to be able to help others. They're not ready to see this. So there is no linear evolution. If you open your scope large enough, this world gives you a very clear view on that. So the last mass extinction happened about 65 million years ago. That's when this meteorite hit the Yucatan. Bang! 80% of all species finished. About 260-something million years ago, 97% of all species finished. And from that, we had to start again. And you look at our civilization, when great empires fell, it was never nice. It was like a really bad divorce, and everything crashed. And we had to start again. So in fact, there is no clear-cut linear evolution that you can point at. Because there is always a critical set of events which erases nearly everything that you've done before. Always. It's true about your individual life, it's true about your family, true about human society in general, and the species history on this planet. You just have to open your mind wide enough to see it, and without any agenda or preconception, look at the way things have been so far. And the question is, what can you really attain? The only thing you can really attain in this situation is a more awakened consciousness at the time of death than the time when you were born. That's it. So coming empty-handed, going empty-handed. That is human. These two lines are from a poem from Zen Master Sun Tzu. And at the end of this poem, there is this really important question. What is this one pure and clear thing? Because life is really like a floating cloud which appears. Death is like a cloud which disappears. This floating cloud originally does not exist. In fact, I just said almost the whole poem. So when you hear that for the first time in your Zen interview, it hits like a Mack truck, because it's so simple and so clear, and it doesn't want you to believe anything, just see clearly. This human situation, your situation, our situation, see clearly, that's all. And then you do, and you see that there is nothing like the advertised ways of life and the advertised human progress and what we are supposed to be proud of as a species. It's all illusory. But what you can personally do, and we can collectively do together, is to leave this life with a more awakened consciousness than the one we brought in. That's something we can do. Because then you attain this one pure and clear thing. And that defines your next birth. Okay? So to our psychologist colleague right in the audience, Western psychology, which I started to disbelieve 22 years ago, and now I approach it from a different point of view, strictly from a Buddhist, you know, practice point of view. Psychology really defines, you know, karma from birth. You know, what kind of family you have, what kind of ancestry you have, what kind of current situation you have. But human psychology, as it was developed in the West, from a very materialistic and monotheistic perspective, never asked the question, what kind of previous life or lives did you have, and why you were born into that situation? It never approaches human unconscious as the eighth consciousness, the alaya vijnana. It never approaches human judgment to a mind as a faculty of the manas, the seventh consciousness. So I believe that as I meet more and more of your profession, both in Hungary and in Korea, perhaps something can become more fusion or kind of more united by virtue of Eastern and Western thought and spiritual experience. And then you can have the correct view of karma and the correct view of dharma together. And that's an amazing experience when you find practicing psychologists and those monks and nuns who don't kind of shun or don't avoid looking at individual karma in great detail. In these tea rooms of the temples, there are many kinds of conversations, but mostly when you drink tea with monks and nuns, you hear wonderful dharma conversation. But how much does it address you? How much can you say your problems? How much can you put your own karma onto the floor and deal with it? It's wonderful to hear personalized dharma talks during drinking tea, but how much does it connect to you? And of course, many of those sunnis, they listen very well. It's great. And many of Western psychologists, they practice some kind of dharma so as to have a personal spiritual path and some kind of clarification, purification inside. Otherwise, they couldn't deal with the workload in their minds. And how many clients do you see per day? 6, 8, 10? 2 or 3 is very healthy. Anything under 5 is okay. Anything above 5 and 6, you're putting yourself and maybe the clients also into danger. Because you cannot empty yourself out. That's really important. So when you want to empty your bathtub, just pull the cork and all the water goes down. But how do you do that to your consciousness? So how do you empty that out? And emptiness in this case like is salvation, because there's more space for other people to be reflected and to be helped in your mind space. So you can clean that up. So there are many, many ways of helping people, but we have to find a way to help ourselves. And that can expand into something naturally. So that kind of expansion is what I'm talking about, because human expansion into time and space and not just this earth, but maybe going beyond the boundaries to Mars or the moon, etc. It's great achievement, but did we really change because of that? Or we are the same marauding animals as 3, 4, 5 thousand years ago? And the answer is really this small. Because the collective output of 7 billion people of this planet, we are making it worse at this point, despite all our great achievements. But there's a collective output of 7 billion people on this earth. Our results are not so fascinating. More questions? I seem to, but let me tell you something. I'm not correcting your question. I just want to put one word into correct perspective, which is the beginning of the answer. You don't distance yourself. When you leave home, in Korea they call it chuga, leaving home. And at first it really hurts the family because it seems that you distance yourself from them. And in Korea, some Sunnis, they never meet their families again, out of the question. Some do after a couple of years. You as a layperson, don't choose to distance yourself because you did not leave home. You have hair, you have a wife or girlfriend, etc., and you become a husband and a father normally if people live that kind of life. When Sunims leave, they don't choose to distance themselves from everything and everyone for the rest of their lives, but they find a way and the means to practice in such a way that they could go beyond their social obligations and then their attachments, etc., etc., put it into a different perspective, and then return to life as a monk or nun and help those people. So that's a kind of larger circle. If you check the 10 Oxford in pictures in Korean, the Shibudo, it tells you a very good step-by-step description how that works. And if you see that, then you can see kind of in a smaller circle within your own life how that happens. So distancing, you don't distance, you just need some time for yourself. So the biggest fear for your wife is if you do something that she doesn't understand and you take too much time, because she believes she's not the first in your life. And it really should happen in such a way, your dharma practice, that this relationship is not breached, or not even weakened. You should say, honey, I'm becoming a better person if you just give me half an hour every morning. And if you're interested, I can explain to you what I'm doing. It's meditation. If you want to know, I can tell you everything. And if you don't want to know, it's fine. You just become a more quiet and more tolerant and more capable person at the end of these practices. And I need your trust and help so that I can do that. Sounds good, huh? That's what she wants to hear from his boyfriend, from her boyfriend. That's what you have to tell your girlfriend, something like that. Huh?
I'll keep it in mind.
Yeah. So what's really important that you don't distance yourself, because if you become a hermit in your own family, that's detrimental. If you want to become a hermit, go up to the mountain and check it out, what it is. Okay? So, what's really fantastic if you find a balance between individual practice and group practice, between everyday life and what we call sangha life, when you're really engaged in the dharma. So what you asked about really calls for the presence of the three precious ones, the Buddha, the dharma, and the sangha. Because what you're asking is not just your own individual practice or your group practice. That's the realm of, you know, sangha life. But what's really important is the dharma that you practice. So that has to be clear enough. So if the teaching is clear, then you're not wasting your time. If the teaching is not clear, you are repeating the flaws built in because somebody was too kind to you. Somebody wanted to be nice. Somebody wanted to appear as a good person and a teacher in your life. This cannot happen. Teachers have to be compassionate enough, but when it's tough time, then they put the student through tough times for the student's sake. Without mitigating anything, without hiding anything, without making things easier for you, because eventually it becomes more difficult. If the student doesn't become strong enough, then dependence appears. And that dependence can be very happy at the beginning, and even mid-term, let alone long-term, it's disastrous. Okay? So, there's another Zen poem which says, outside the door a puppy is whimpering. Don't kill it with kindness. So, I really want to appreciate your presence today, your wonderful attention, and I wish that all of us could enter the path of clear mind and perception so that we could truly attain our true nature. If we do that, we do a favor not just for ourselves, becoming more wise and compassionate and more enlightened person than before, but we actually do a good favor for everyone else. The suffering that we experience is something we make. If you don't make that suffering, it doesn't happen. Suffering doesn't have a nature of its own. It's impermanent, it's imperfect, and it's interdependent. So when you realize that, that's how it checks. Suffering doesn't exist by itself. And that is something which you can use after seeing the root as a solution. And you can build that into your methods to follow that way to the solution. So thank you for coming today. And let's hope that we can meet again and practice again sometime later. I appreciate your attention and wish you well for the future. Thank you.